So, wow, this is definitely not the video I was expecting to be making. I've been kind of thinking about making this for a while since these ideas have been floating around my brain for several years. So I threw it onto the poll rather haphazardly because I didn't have a whole lot of idea of what I was going to do for a video this month. And the amount of attention it got winning both polls on YouTube and Twitter kind of blew me away. And now that we're here are some things you should probably know first. A, I am a Christian, but I'm also very young and not the most educated, so take what I say with a grain of salt. I make these videos for entertainment value and maybe a little bit to get people to view things differently, but what I say is extremely subjective, and people's thoughts and opinions do change. And B, I'm going to be talking about a lot of the things I did in my Midnight Mass video, in terms of themes and why I don't like most Christian and biblical media, in terms of TV shows and movies, or even books. So I'd suggest maybe watching that video first. It's not necessary, but I will be pretty briefly talking about the stuff that I've already talked about in that video. So strap in as I dive into finding faith in film, searching beyond the borders.
Standing at the precipice of a newly birthed world, as the first gift I lay unto thee, time, one to govern, to live through, to understand, for they will be guided and ended by it. We who remain outside shall remain and see, and those who are not shall be defined by it. They will not understand.
So, little known fact about the creation of film and moving pictures as a medium is that what they have done for us as a literary and scientific society is introduced us to a deeper and visual understanding of things we couldn't otherwise see or understand, bringing to life things that we would have never dreamed of, but that would one day become realities. And one of these things that film has brought to life in a new way is time. The concept of time is obviously something we've pretty much always had. The sun always comes up and down. We've been able to learn from the stars and the moon and the creation of clocks and calendars. We've known all about time. We as a people have always been very much defined by it. Before electricity, people would just kind of get up with the sun and follow it to bed. We live in it, we flow through it. But one thing that got played around with pretty early in the concept of sci-fi and fantasy literature was the idea of bending time. Even the thought of taking the reader to a different time through their words. Maybe characters jump through time, can freeze time, or can see the future of time. Concepts that could put our characters in never before thought of situations and bring forth more powerful themes or ideas. But, like reading C.S. Lewis's space trilogy now that we actually know what space is and how it exists and interacts with us, these ideas, even if they fit into the general logic and use of time, never really brought them to life in a way that would challenge the way people generally thought of time. We had no real concept of what it would be like to see something actually traveling backwards in time or be on different levels of time or even to slow down time and to truly see it. These concepts may have been touched upon in literature, but we never really brought them to life in a way that understood how they would be until the creation of the moving picture. And as you may have imagined, this has drastically changed the way we've been able to understand and explore concepts of time. Take even a director like Christopher Nolan, a man rather well known for his obsession with flow and layers of time in movies, from Memento to Inception to even The Prestige or Tenet. Each breaks down different concepts of time, usually brought to life in a way that only cinema truly allows. We can now see what it looks like for people to be running on two different streams of time, or what it means for your dreams to always feel so out of time. So many insane concepts brought to life, each overflowing with questions and ideas and research and genuine thought and science put behind them. Again, they wanted it to be so accurate for Interstellar that they made one of the first ever realistic models of a black hole that they literally had like full-blown research projects done on because it was so revolutionary to bring it to visual life. But why am I talking about all this? We just went from religion to science in a couple of seconds, so what gives? Well, believe it or not, they're not void from each other, and for me and my faith personally, one of my favorite things to explore is science, as deeply and richly as I can, connecting it to what I believe in the Bible and concepts of God. It's literally one of my favorite things, which is why I've gone out of my way to try and learn science from the top places that I can, exploring the way that the world has been created, and how God even is as a being, and putting it into my faith. To which movies come in? I started making a list a while back of movies that I felt touched with my faith in a way that most Christian movies never did. Stuff that would really dig deep and emotionally connect with me on top of just being a good movie, which again is very rare for your average quote-unquote Christian movie. So I wanted to break down why this was. I wanted to understand the concepts of what made these movies connect with my faith and share them with people, because I think finding faith in film is a super important thing for somebody who likes film and is also religious. And to start us off, the first way I want to dive into my faith in movies will be looking at a 2016 movie from a little-known French-Canadian director in what might be the longest-running series of back-to-back masterpieces ever dropped, Arrival. As I said, this was the first movie that got me to start the list, and it got me to look at movies, especially sci-fi and fantasy movies, through a completely different lens that would forever change the way I viewed my faith, my life, and God, the concept of being out of the story. Let me explain. Arrival follows the main character, Dr. Luis Banks, an expert linguist, I think is how you say it, who's brought onto a government case when the world is shaken by the appearance of 12 spacecrafts that have landed all across the world that seem to be trying to communicate with people. The world, of course, goes into panic and mayhem as the governments of the world rush to try and work together, or against each other, to figure out what it all means. Dr. Banks is taken into the spacecraft where she starts to do her work and connect with the foreign species, and she finds that the real language isn't vocals at all, it's written. Nonlinear symbols creating fully formed statements all at once. As she deep dives more and more into understanding the language, it starts to take over her mind, and she starts to think about things differently. Her and us as the audience start seeing memories or moments flashing through briefly, disorienting her. And as the tension of the movie builds, and they're about to go into all-out war with the aliens, Luis escapes the military and gets taken into the chamber with the aliens for the, quote, weapon, or tool, that they wish to offer the human race, and what she ends up being given is a full and true understanding of their language. And as the movie postulates, with a full understanding of a non-linear language, she herself becomes non-linear. She starts fully experiencing moments of all of her life all at once, in any order, jumping from point to point, and she uses this to end up stopping all of the militaries around the world. But what's revealed, and is really the emotional core of the movie, is that the memories she has been seeing since the beginning of the film of her daughter's life and tragic, unavoidable death and the separation of her and her husband haven't happened yet. She's never been married, and never had kids of any kind. And now she's not only seen, but felt the immense, indescribable, previously unexplainable emotion of her child, and their life, and the fights, and the joy, and the pain, and the death, and the partnership, and losing it all. The man who she's fallen in love with in the course of the movie is the man who she would marry and have a kid with and lose everything with. Her child barely makes it into her teens. She sees and knows and looks at everything in its glorious melancholy, and she decides to do it anyway. To live the life she sees, to love the man that she does, to bring the child into the world and love her with all her heart, understanding the value of love and life and choice beyond all knowing, to just live, not despite the things that will happen, but with them, to understand the girl and to have her for those years and to love her and have the relationship that she does. She chooses it all. It's genuinely a beautiful movie. One of my all-time favorite endings and one of my favorite movies in general. And if you haven't guessed how this plays deeply into my faith and understanding of God, the concept of someone out of time who sees all that has been and is, sees all the good and all the bad in the world and the hardship that comes, but still chooses to give free will and not control from this standpoint, deeply changes my understanding of the way God operates. It kind of blew my mind and opened my mind and deepen my faith to dig deeper into what I believed and what I thought through the Bible and God. And that's what's so powerful to me about this specific kind of film that fits into my list that I made. Usually sci-fi or fantasy that can explore so much beyond what our understanding might normally be. Going with another movie I mentioned earlier, Interstellar is again another movie that spoke to me and my faith even when I watch it now. Again, playing with the concept of being out of time, and this time with a father who gets separated from their child through time, and is doing whatever they can to try and connect with them and show them that they're still there and still trying to help them. These were the first two movies to jump out to me into this deep dive into understanding movies through a different lens. This ability to connect to the way I viewed concepts of humanity and God on a scientific level through film. First Man was another on this kind of story, being a little bit more personal and human through the eyes of a true story. And it just kept growing and growing as I looked at other aspects in film in which I could find things and relate to and connect with. Films that I had seen before, even beyond just science in the films. In the deepest corners and the most direct senses, I was ready to dive into faith and film even deeper.
Great was the calling of the people for righteousness. Great was the suffering, and none knew how to survive. Listen now, before I go, listen to the sunrise.
Watership Down, Narnia, The Prince of Egypt, Doubt, First Reformed. What do all of these have in common? Well, it's actually pretty easy to tell. But, religion and faith. So this next little section I like to call allegory or just a straight up religion. Most of what falls into these movies are ones that heavily use biblical ideas, stories, and concepts to tell their story or directly parallel or even discuss actual things in biblical text. It's a bit more broad, but to cover all of the ways I look at movies in this video is just a lot, so we're clumping them together. From Aslan and Narnia literally just being Jesus, to There Will Be Blood literally trying to be a biblical parable, these movies encapsulate what most people would probably think of as Christian movies, but as I talked about in my Midnight Mass video, quote-unquote Christian movies usually get so much wrong in writing themselves as essentially propaganda films, only for Christians to feel better about themselves with the very little persecution we feel in our nice American lives.
Guy walks into a doctor's office. He says, "Doc, you've got to help me. I've got this horrible Twitter addiction." Doctor says, "Sorry."
The movies I actually find bring my faith and help me dig deeper into what I believe and keep me in check trying to live my life for God are usually movies like Doubt or even something like Midnight Mass, as I discussed. These usually are more specifically about Catholicism, which, fair enough, and I guess we haven't really gotten to the point in our society that evangelicals could handle this amount of direct criticism, but even with them using Catholicism and a lot of stuff I don't believe, these movies always dig in so deep to the heart of what it means to be a religion, or to believe in God in general. Doubt is a beautiful character study with some of the greatest actors of all time weaving a small, simple story about doubt in church and in God and in people around you and faith and corruption and trying to teach faith and God in a modern way. It's genuinely one of the most powerful movies I've seen, with some of the all-time best performances pretty much that I've ever seen. And the way that it doesn't fully wrap up together until the very last scene in a nice little bow is amazing. I just recently, while actually writing this script, I actually am going off script here because I watched it after I finished off the script, watched Silence by Martin Scorsese, a beautiful, deep, and hard-to-watch movie, really digging deep into faith and Catholicism and a lot of the specific things I disagree about the way that they spread faith and about colonization, and it all comes together in one of the most beautifully brutal movies I've ever seen. Genuinely one of the best movies talking about faith I've ever seen. It's such a great, well-rounded, well-crafted story, and yes, that has been added to this list.
Your life is with me now. Step.
The Prince of Egypt, off on its own over here, is honestly one of, if not the only, direct biblical story brought to life in film that I not only love and think is well written, but I also think captures the spirit of the text and brings it to life in a new way that deepens the perspective of a lot of these stories that were really written in a more historical document way and helps you understand. I don't really have any other examples of this kind of movie to go with it, because it's such a rare thing to happen, using the brilliance of animation and music to capture the spirit of the Bible and truly bring this story to life. It's one of my favorite animated movies ever. My personal favorite kind of movies in this section, though, end up usually accomplishing the ideas and missions of both of these other two that I've talked about in a very unique way, using fantastical parallels and allegory. The Narnia book series is one of my all-time favorites in the world for taking the ideas of faith and religion and so many complicated biblical ideas and reframing them, presenting them with new questions and ideas and landscapes. The Last Battle is like top three favorite book ever. The way it paints the end of time and the idea of heaven and the way everything plays out is amazing and beautiful, and helps recontextualize the way I look at things. Unfortunately, it's never been adapted into a movie that I know of. Give me a budget and an animation team, and I will get on it. And honestly, the adaptations of the Narnia series to movies that we do have always kind of disappointed me. I hated Prince Caspian. I couldn't even make it through Don Treader on a rewatch. But The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, arguably the easiest to bring to life, quite frankly, is actually pretty darn good in what it pulls off from the text. It means probably the least to me out of the book series, but especially the bringing to life of Aslan and the fantastical creatures, and just the way his presence is in the movie, is what carries me through, and what has always been the most interesting part to me of the book series. Another movie in this category that means so much to me is Watership Down. Something I had only watched for the first time in recent years that absolutely blew me away. All I knew about it going in was that it was a rabbit war movie, but what I found when I watched it was a deep, rich tale about life and God and being followed by death all your life, feeling like you're cursed and hopelessness and doubt and government and literally so much all in this movie of rabbits, following a vision to essentially get to a promised land. The scene at the end of the movie when the black rabbit comes and they greet each other as friends and he comes to join the war and is such a powerful and beautiful moment to me. Reaching out in 88 minutes to touch on life and mortality and the relationship mortality plays into God and the struggle of all kinds of beauty in life is almost understated on how impressive it is for this almost surreal, violent bunny movie. And that's the real skill and power of movies like this. For this whole section, beyond anything of the concepts of science, these come down to actual relationships with God and religion. And even the concept of living your whole life running to something that may not be there. Bringing to life Jesus in a way that sure as heck no movie that is actually about Jesus does. Really reaching beyond the surface and touching deep into ideas with some of the simplest and most hard to watch and heartfelt stories out there. But there's another category that I wanted to talk about that's honestly touched me and my faith almost more so than this category has. Reaching out and touching my day-to-day thoughts and feelings and ideas and struggle with faith.
left in silence as the sun sets its final path, searching for some hope, some life, comes depth beyond. So in the darkness, I go on.
So a lot of my list confuses people when I've shown it to them in the past. Most of which, rather understandably, again, all of this is rather personal to me and very subjective. This final and honestly most powerful to me section, I like to call Absence Of, or The Humanities. Movies like Dead Poets Society, Paranoia Agent, not technically a movie but still, and even something like Parasite. I was actually questioned on this specific choice the first time I showed the list to my mom. How could I relate something like Parasite to my faith? And I understand questioning it. A movie narrating how, when we have no hope and no trust in anything or anyone around us, and we're just trying to survive, we'll tear each other apart while other people who actually have what we need and want aren't even aware we exist. It's dark and depressing and nihilistic. Or even Paranoia Agent, a story in which a supernatural being born out of paranoia from a scared girl about her father being mad at a lie she told ends up causing not only several attacks, but increasingly brutal murders and suicide and, well, paranoia, depicting yet again how much we'll take rumors and propaganda and media and use it to tear each other apart and find ways out of everything in life by blaming it on something out of control. Again, extremely dark, much more so than Parasite, honestly, and very nihilistic. And even one of the examples that's tonally different from these, Dead Poets Society, in which young boys' lives are being controlled for them, and a father figure of sorts comes into their lives, teaching them about art and beauty and love and what it really means to live their lives, not just doing what their parents and the school say to do. And they get torn apart for it, leading to a tragic event, after one of their actual fathers doesn't accept the new love for art. Even with a slightly more hopeful tone and ending compared to the other two, these movies show and beat you down into the ground with how much humanity and ourselves and the systems we set up can cause so much of our own problems and tear us down to the point of barely even being human. In fact, a lot of my favorite stories are tragedies and connect deeply with many of these themes, even ones that didn't make the list, like Pan's Labyrinth and The Thing and recent movies like Nightmare Alley. The exploration of humanity on a broad scale has always fascinated me in a dark tone. And in it, as I was watching more and more of it, becoming more enthralled with these kind of stories and curious as to why, my girlfriend can attest that literally all I try and watch with her are long, sad movies, usually about something depressing or horrifying. I found something deeper for me than what was just the surface lessons these movies were teaching or the points they were trying to make, that really connected to my faith and my experiences. In the absence of all hope and beauty and kindness, left completely to ourselves with nothing but to survive and make it through this increasingly apparent corrupt world, which these movies are showing, what always ends up sticking with me when the credits roll are the small breaths in between, the glances at the brief good, the hope that shines through in the cracks. Dead Poets Society is one of the most feel-good movies for me until it's not, because these characters get to truly discover art for the first time in their lives. They come together and find themselves and each other, and the words that they poorly craft and throw together create powerful moments and give them hope because they're everything that they have. It's the art they make that finally allows them to connect to themselves. And in my personal belief, art is truly a gift that God gave us to be able to connect not only with each other, but with them. It's not just words on a page or pictures on a screen, and even in some of the more depressing ones that hardly have any of these breathable moments like Paranoia Agent, the depravity they hit feels like a call to the opposite and brings to life my mind on what I'm living my own life like. The nothing matters scene in Parasite is not only one of the greatest scenes probably ever, but it speaks to me so much as a reminder in my everyday life to not get complacent or lose hope and cling to the ideas that tear us apart, because when nothing matters, then anything can happen. And that's how we lose who we are as humans made by God. Also, shout out to Everything Everywhere All at Once for being kind of the antithesis to this movie. It's actually amazing. You should go check it out. It sounds goofy and pretentious because it kind of is, but they're in a way even more so modern day parables than something like There Will Be Blood that speak to me specifically in such a rich, emotional way that only movies and storytelling can. The way Paranoia Agent weaves its stories and its characters till you yourself become paranoid and feel the effects of the lies and stories told around to the point of the characters feeling like they have to give up to come to where it feels like it would be such a relief to get attacked, to escape. The scene where Akari's wife finally figures it out and manages to fight against the little slugger is honestly one of the most powerful and inspirational and spiritual scenes for me in anything I've ever seen. It's a freaking depressing and creepy show, but its messages about life and faith are second to none. This section, like I said, is so much more powerful to me than the first two, connecting not only to how I see God through film, how I keep faith to find God through the crazy, insane, overwhelming, depressing, and scary world we live through every day. That's why so many of these are my favorite movies in general. The way they actually reach out and get me to connect with God in a way that almost nothing else does. Almost all of my top four can fall into this category, playing into the ideas and themes about art and humanity and faith.
Deep beyond the universe, the understanding of life and text leaves only one thing to truly know: faith. So we search for it in all things great and small, for ours is of good and natural life, finding meaning in a mustard seed, leaving the world as a call to help, as a call to itself, left by all who inhabit it. Those voices will not fall flat in the sight of God.
Movies are an art form. I think pretty much everyone agrees on that. And art in its truest and deepest form is what brings us together as people, what truly connects us beyond time and form and experience, no matter where we are. Connecting to it doesn't only show us ourselves and the lives we live on a level we can't understand otherwise, but it can also connect us to hope and love and, well, faith. Why do I try and stretch to find faith in films I watch? Why did I make a whole video talking about the random contrived reasons and very subjective reasons that I find faith in the films that I watch and my taste in art? It's because I truly believe that films have power over our lives, like most media, almost more so than other medias they combine. Their ability to be almost anything and connect to almost anyone, and to connect with me, is to know my faith in that love and hope I try to cling to. And since the movies, quote-unquote, of my faith aren't showing any of those things in any way, let alone in an enjoyable, well-made way, I look to the films I do love to try and find hope in them, and to try and find God and humanity. And it's helped me grow so much, both in my faith and just as a person in general. It's inspired me to dive so much deeper into the Bible and into God and to never give up. And I know it's no holy thing in itself, but I think that's what makes art so important to me as a person, whether it's music or books or paintings or film. I search for myself, and I search for the love and reflection of God.
Thank you, boys. Thank you.
Thanks for watching, and again, this stuff is very subjective and some of the points are exaggerated. Whatever you believe about faith, religion, movies, or art is valid, but tell me in the comments what you agree with or disagree with about the films I find faith in, or some films that have meant something in your life, whether spiritually or not. I truly believe one of the best things we can do as humans on the planet is love and enjoy other people's art. So go and watch some good movies and maybe try and think about what it is that you love about these pieces of media that mean so much to you, even if it's just haha funny movie that can still be important for your life. And yeah, it's been a crazy month for me. I was the lead in another show, which was cool and crazy, and I've been working a ton, so sorry for this being a little bit lighter and weird, but I hope you guys enjoyed. Thank you so much for all the attention my channel has been getting. It means the world to me, and I'm glad you guys can enjoy what I make. We're getting very, very close to 1,000 subscribers, and I'm very excited for that, and the video I'll be making when that happens. Shout out to my Patreon supporter. Yes, there's still only one, and he's family, but he's awesome and amazing and has been probably the biggest supporter to this channel, especially on a resources department. So thank you, Robbie Grayway, and I will see you all next month.